One of the biggest problems that I have had right from the beginning with the climate scare is that it is so obviously without any scientific foundation. And so 4 years ago, when I was first called in, this is late 2006, by a boutique finance house in the City of London whose CEO got in touch, he said, look, we don't know what to make of this. Our analysts don't know whether it's a real problem or it isn't. We want to know whether we should be pushing everybody into green investments or pushing them the other way. And I said, well, the last time I looked 20 years ago when I worked for Margaret Thatcher, it was a problem. So I'll have another look. And I saw that, sure enough, the problem had been looked at, it had been found not to be a problem. It was really quite clear there was no problem. And yet, an enormous industry had grown up, fueled partly by the communist environmental movement, fueled partly by communist countries supporting the communist environmental movement, financially and in other ways, to try to say that there was a scientific problem. Now, naturally, if there isn't a problem, but there are very powerful forces trying to pretend that there is, then in order to do that, they have to suborn a small but powerful clique internationally of scientists to make their suggestions of global disaster sound halfway plausible. So when I had realized from my initial month of researches and the 40-page report that I did to the bank that there wasn't a problem, I then said to the bank, I said, well, I'm now going to look a bit more at this. I want to see who the scientists are that have been suborned by the political process or are themselves, without declaring it, effectively communists. So I began to look at various scientists, very eminent, or not so much eminent as prominent, which is not always the same thing, in the climate field, whose work was plainly bogus. And I began studying the kind of papers they were writing, the kind of bogosity that they were building in to their papers. I began studying how it was that they got these papers past peer review and into the published journals. And then I began to find it was the same names that kept cropping up. There were only about 20 of them. And the same names that also appeared to be totally in control both of the process of peer review in the leading journals that dealt with the climate, particularly those journals that took an avowedly alarmist point of view, such as Science, Nature, Geophysical Research, Letters, and the others. And I also found that these people were simultaneously in control of the process of the UN's climate panel, the IPCC, as it's called. And, for instance, in the 2001 report, by that stage, a number of nations had realized that maybe there wasn't the problem that everyone had told them there was. And they began saying so in the final sessions that settled the 2001 report. And each individual government representative who expressed any serious doubts that looked as though they might carry weight in the deliberations of all the governments settling the final draft of that report was pulled aside into a side room. And there, in that side room, was always a small subset of around 6 or 7 of these 20 or 24 scientists that I had been following. It was the same group. So when the University of East Anglia came to public attention in around November of 2009. What happened was that emails on its university server between various scientists prominent in the global warming discussions, all of them on the extremely and avowedly climate extremist or alarmist side of the debate, became public. Almost certainly because a whistleblower inside the university who had access to its mainframe was able to take down the emails off the mainframe over a period of months to edit them to take out any personal details that might unduly hurt those who were writing these emails, and including blanking out half of their addresses so you could see who they were, but you couldn't start emailing them if you didn't like what they'd said. Very carefully done, not by a hacker, it's clearly by a whistleblower. And the whistleblower released this entire 10 years of emails between these scientists to the BBC. And the BBC, which is a true believer in the global warming scam, deliberately sat on those emails and did not release them to the public or mention that they exist. This situation persisted for a month, and when the whistleblower realised the BBC was simply not going to reveal the story, he passed it out via a Russian website to the rest of the world so that everybody could pick it up. And then everybody did pick it up, and indeed one of the few organisations which has still not mentioned what is in these emails is the BBC, which sullenly refuses to do its duty to inform and educate the population of Britain on what these emails say. What they revealed, and revealed to me the moment I saw them, was that exactly the 24 people I had been following for 3 or 4 years, the people who were clearly manipulating the data and the results, pushing the arguments beyond reason in an attempt artificially to create a climate of fear, the people who were clearly manipulating the data and the results, pushing the arguments beyond reason in an attempt artificially to create a climate of fear about the climate. These were exactly the same people who were now proven to be linked to one another by the emails they were exchanging over the University of East Anglia's server. Because Professor Phil Jones of the University of East Anglia was the compiler of the global temperature data set for the past 160 years, which the UN itself relies upon in its climate panel as the definitive record of how temperatures have changed over that period. So he was a very important part of this process of, and I'm going to call it what it is, fabrication of scientific evidence. And he, together with Tom Carl, who runs the National Climatic Data Center of the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration here in the States, together with James Hansen and Gavin Schmidt at NASA, together with various others from around the world, Michael Mann at Penn State University was another one. These people were deliberately manipulating the data. And they were saying in these emails that they were manipulating the data. And every time an uncongenial result came out from the data, they would alter it or tamper with it or try to suppress the other point of view in the scientific journals. And they even had open discussions about how they were going to make absolutely sure that anyone who disagreed with them, that the world was doomed, was not going to be allowed to have any input whatsoever into the subsequent reports of the UN's climate panel, which they substantially controlled. And indeed, I can give an example of this, because I wanted to attend what is called the scoping meeting in Hawaii this time last year to prepare for the next or fifth of these great reports done by the UN's climate panel, which is due out in 2013. And they were going to outline what things they needed to look at in the report. So I wanted to contribute to that process, and in particular I wanted to draw attention to the fact that it appeared we can now explain the up and down fluctuations of the temperature record over the last 150 years. These appear to be caused by changes in cloud cover that occur quite naturally. And if you subtract out the effect of those changes in cloud cover, then the remaining temperature change, even if it had been measured accurately, which we know from the ClimateGate emails, it wasn't. They were tampering with that as well to make it look as though there'd been more warming than there had been. But even then, if you subtract out these changes in cloud cover, then the room for CO2 or any other greenhouse gas to have a very large influence on climate is actually negligible. And I wanted that to be properly looked at. I wanted to go to the scoping meeting. I wanted to present a short paper explaining what research needed to be done, how it should be done, get it set up so that by the time the document was finally produced, the research would already be in and available. And I was very firmly told by one of the ClimateGate emailers, who had been a lead author of the last two UN climate reports, that I would be most unwelcome at that meeting and that I was not to come, and if I did come, security would throw me out. And this is supposed to be the open, transparent scientific process, listening to all scientific voices. Now, okay, I'm not qualified in the sciences. I don't pretend to be, except in mathematics. But I nevertheless have a certain knowledge of this subject. I have, as any other citizen of this planet has, a right to be heard, and I wished to be heard. And I was denied the right to be heard, and this is the reason why. They said, because you have not contributed to the scientific literature, which, as it happens, I have, and because, in any case, we know your point of view, and it doesn't agree with that of the UN. And they actually said that to me. And so we can see, therefore, this group of ClimateGate emailers ruthlessly controlling the UN agenda, and then they have the cheek to say, aha, well, of course, we have an absolute scientific consensus. Yes, of course we do, because anyone who doesn't share that consensus view is not allowed to participate. Let me give you another example. Professor Paul Reiter, who is, on any view, the world's foremost expert on the epidemiology of the malaria and yellow fever and other vector-borne infections. These are diseases carried by, usually by mosquitoes. He knows all about this. And he was nominated by the United States to take part in the preparation of the last of the IPCC reports, the fourth assessment report published in 2007. He knew that once he was nominated, the bureaucrats at the UN's climate panel would do anything rather than allow him to participate. So he took care to send his nomination papers, duly signed by the State Department and authorized, to four separate senior UN bureaucrats by registered post with advice of delivery so that he could prove to them later that they had received his nomination papers. Sure enough, he wasn't appointed by the UN, even though he'd been nominated by the United States. And when he inquired why he hadn't been nominated, he was told, because we didn't receive your nomination papers. So he then said, right, here is my proof that four of you did receive my nomination papers and that you were all people to whom those nomination papers should validly have been sent. So when they realized that he had got them into a trap, they said, okay, we will allow you to be a reviewer of the subchapter on malaria and other tropical diseases. And he then, I'm glad to say, had the chance of more or less completely rewriting it, because the people they chose as lead authors were both not scientists. They were environmental campaigners who had got only one published paper on this subject between them in the literature, whereas he has hundreds. And so he simply rewrote all the gibberish that they wrote about how malaria was going to spread because of global warming. It isn't. And he made it quite plain. And that at least was corrected. Then there was another scientist, Garth Paltridge, in Australia, who came out one day and he said he wasn't happy with the UN process. He didn't think it was producing valid science. The conclusions were wrong. Global warming isn't a problem. Within 24 hours of his saying that, the UN had contacted the Funding Council for Science in Australia, which then rang Paltridge and said, if you ever say anything like that in public again, we will make sure that you do no science anywhere, your tenure is taken away, and all funding will be cut off. Now, of course, once again, that's a very easy way to achieve a consensus. What is astonishing is how these stories are happening all over the place, time and time and time again. I could sit here for hours and tell you stories of how the UN's climate panel has deliberately excluded people that disagree with it, including me. But the point is, the mainstream news media have never asked any of these questions. They sit like pudding. It doesn't ever question whether science is done by consensus anyway, which it isn't, or whether the UN's climate panel genuinely represents anything other than this narrow faction whose links with one another were proven by the ClimateGate emails.